From the sandy beaches of Mogadishu, you are listening to Postcards from Somalia. I am your host, Alan Mosley, joined as always by my co-host and now offering masks and toilet paper at only $99.99 each. It's Sherry Voluntary. Sherry, how are you doing?
I'm not dead yet.
So, I mean, I know you know this, that the masks only, that's the masks are for people who are already sick to not get other people sick.
Right.
So are you here tonight saying that you have a coronavirus?
I have something.
So then in that case, we should probably declare a state of emergency.
Yeah, I mean, I think so. In Somalia, there should be a state of emergency because I have some kind of disease.
In our compound in Somalia, you have coronavirus and I don't, which for us, that means 50% of our population has coronavirus. We're done.
Oh my God, it's the end.
It's over.
No Lysol can save us now.
We're going to have to push through some kind of like maybe perhaps an $8 billion fund to help address this situation.
I bet if someone gave me $8 million, $8 billion, mm-hmm. I could be cured. Send money now. Save one life.
It reminds me of that South Park episode where the kids get AIDS and they're trying to figure out how to cure it. And they go to Magic Johnson and he helps them find the cure. But what the cure is literally taking a ton of money, distilling it down into a vaccine. And they inject it and then they're cured.
Yeah. Those masks are pretty gross, actually. Like you know, they're like you're breathing your own breath and it's kind of gross that way. And then it like makes my nose hurt. Kind of makes the end of your nose raw. I don't like it.
Yeah.
But, I mean, the Japanese do it because they're polite.
Yeah. Well, that's – well, because on the one hand, they're trying to not get other people sick.
Right.
On the other hand, they still got to go about their day because, you know.
Because they're Japanese. They got shit to do.
Yeah, they got shit to do. They're trying – I mean, you know, they have a 21-hour workday over there. So, I mean, you got a lot to get done.
I did read I used to read, because I love Japan. I'm like, since I was 5, I was a little bit obsessed with it.
Are you a fucking weeb?
I sort of am, only I'm not as into anime. I like some anime, but like when I was 5 years old, I saw Shogun. I snuck up to watch it because I was just like, that miniseries. I mean, you probably don't know because you're so young, but I've loved Japan ever since, and I used to read everything I could, whatever. I used to read this blog on Japan, and one of the things they were talking about is people literally sleeping at their desks for days. Like they would be at their desk and they would like take an hour to sleep at the desk and then they would go right back to work because it's not against the law. They want to please the corporation or whatever, and so I couldn't live like that. I'm not that motivated. Like I would be the worst Japanese person ever if I lived over there, because I'm not sleeping at, I mean, I might sleep at my desk, but it's not so that I can stay and work longer.
So what you're trying to say is that you would be the worst Japanese person ever, but you're a passable American, though.
I'm totally a good American. I'm fat and everything. And now I have coronavirus. So you know what's interesting about coronavirus, too? Is that, like, now the left is all, you know, they want it's not just the left who want the government to do something. But many of the people who are leftists also believe that we have a population problem, correct?
Mm-hmm.
But now they're arguing for people to be saved from the scourge because the President Trump is getting involved and saying it's not a big deal, which, I mean, he's an idiot too. We know that. But it's like, I don't know. It seems like this might be a boon for those people going, well, we have a population problem. And so maybe this is the most humane way. Like let nature sort it out.
Well, I mean, there is something to be said for, like, unless you're one of these uber tinfoil hats that think that coronavirus was actually created by the Japanese or the Chinese to cull people. If you're one of those people, then obviously this doesn't apply. But if you think that coronavirus is actually a product of nature, then, I mean, it's not like people shouldn't assign malicious intent to things.
Right. Just because.
Like, it's not. Yeah, just because coronavirus exists doesn't mean like, oh, and therefore you're trying to kill us or vice versa. That's a little much. But With that said, though, I mean, in the grand scheme of things, it's not like that many people have or are, you know, fatally in danger of coronavirus.
Right. And I mean, the old people they just refuse to expose themselves anymore. So
thank God.
Not that kind of exposure. Where are the Spartans when we need them? That's what I'm saying. We could deal with boomer problem. The Spartans had no boomer problem, all right? Just saying.
Well, it's not like coronavirus is some sort of unique thing unlike anything that has ever been seen before. Right. Like we've eradicated things like smallpox and polio and stuff like that. And I mean, the flu exists. It's a virus, and you can't just guarantee that people won't get it.
In fact, lots of people get it.
And then, in fact, lots of people die. That's right. So, I mean, it's more, I know people have made the analogies of it's more akin to something like the flu. It's kind of like a new flu that never existed before.
Right.
So, yeah, the numbers aren't there right now, but what if it spread? Then it could potentially be a lot. But I mean, the point being is that it's not like we've never seen any diseases like that to exist in the history of mankind. And I mean, you know, and just like with cancer, like we don't have a pill you can take and not ever get cancer. We don't have a pill you can take and make sure that you'll never get the flu.
Yes, we do. They just won't let us have it, Alan Mosley.
Yes, that's what it is. I don't have my tinfoil hat.
The rich folks have it. Oh, wait, John McCain.
Yeah.
Like if anybody was going to get that pill, you know they'd keep John McCain alive.
Yeah. So, you know, this is why we just got to get to altered carbon universe where, I mean, your sleeve will die eventually, but you just put on a new one.
Give me a stack. Just do it. I'm ready to go. Like,
I'm not ready to go though. I'm a Kellist. I think that all the stacks should go away.
Well, good for you. I'll take a new body, please. Only I want my clones to be my like 20-year-old self with my older brain.
But even within their universe where that exists, I mean, they're very expensive and rich people have them. Right. So you either A, will just die, or B, you're going to get the sleeve. You're going to get John McCain. They're going to give you John McCain's sleeve. So you'll get another 5 years, but you'll be John McCain.
Yeah, let's get rid of it. Yeah. I don't want that.
Okay. I was just making sure.
I can get a black market skin, you know, sleeve on the, like, of a child or something, some baby.
Oh, that's gotta be it. So you're buying and selling kids on the black market, eh?
I mean, I have two for sale. I keep trying, but nobody's buying. I keep hearing there's this like child trafficking stuff, but ain't nobody buying my kids or even making an offer. So,
you know, one thing I will say that's kind of like interesting about all this is that I know that there's people out there that are not necessarily panicking, not necessarily not. But people have said that, well, wait a minute, though. Now that everyone knows that news is all fake and corporate media is bullshit, it's hard for me to know if I should be panicking over this or not. Because some people are saying it's all fake and some people are saying panic.
Right.
And I can't trust anyone. Therefore, am I or am I not about to die?
Right.
Like, should I stay in my home for 6 months or should I just laugh at everyone else and do whatever I want?
Right.
And I mean, I can't sit here and tell you with certainty that I know what's going to happen.
Right, yeah.
You know?
And but you're exactly right, though. I was watching some people go back and forth on Twitter about it, like some educated people, because I don't know. Like, I'm not terrified of it, but I'm not saying there is no risk. Like, you could get it. It could make you very sick. Maybe you die. I don't know. But that could happen with, like you said, the flu. It can happen with lots of things. So, and what you were saying before, it's like, they probably didn't invent this in a lab in order to make people sick. That doesn't also mean that political types aren't going to use this to the best of their advantage. Like, they didn't create this particular crisis, but damn it, they're going to not let it go to waste, right? So
yeah.
I think that's part of it, is that you can look at the politics or the politicians trying to take, you know, which they always do in crisis, try and take more power. And people are handing it up to them. Oh, please do something. And the things that they do take power. And you can look at that and say, oh, well, see, they created it. But no, they're very, very good opportunists. They take what is given them and turn it to their advantage. So one does not mean the other happened. And likewise, it could be this major pandemic that people are talking about. I don't believe it is, but it could get out of hand and a lot of people could get sick. I doubt as many people are going to die from it or get that the disease of it. Mm-hmm. But, you know, it definitely is spreading. And there, I saw one of the, like, just watching the people back and forth debate made me realize how little I actually know about it. And and that there could be some concern. It may actually have, like, they were going back and forth about the statistics and what the percentages are. But the thing is that, yes, the percentages of death seem higher right now, but they've not been able to even test all the people to see. Like, we have years and years and years and years of data on the flu to give us some kind of numbers of what's typical. We don't have that in this case. So the numbers sound really scary. And so people are, do something. And, you know, this is not new. Like, when I was in high school, I had worked in a nursing home. And one of the things that they knew was going to happen every year was that when they gave the flu shots, because they always give the flu shots to the people in the home, that some of them were going to die. They knew this. This was not like, oh, we're not going to give the flu shot because some people will die. No, they recognize that they have to keep disease down or whatever, and they just do it. And, you know, wish them luck. Mm-hmm. But I don't know if that's policy. But.
So what you're saying is that if we just spread the coronavirus to all the nursing homes, then our healthcare costs are going to go way down.
I wasn't actually saying that, but I may have been saying that inadvertently.
I mean, I'm not saying that that's the moral thing to do. I'm just simply saying that.
Yeah.
That I'm just saying that if you did do that,
right? I mean,
then there'd be, you know.
This maybe makes the case for some kind of a god or a higher presence than our own, because, you know, we have a boomer problem, and now we have a cure. I'm just saying that. Maybe this is God's will. I don't know. I'm just saying. It's possible, wow. Right? Everything's possible.
Wow. That's all I have to say to that as well.
Comments.
I feel like this is more likely to get us deplatformed than just saying the N-word.
Just say the N-word and get it done. Get it over with. We're done already.
So if you took the coronavirus to Harlem, then
That's called Planned Parenthood. That's what Planned Parenthood does.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
That's how they perform abortions.
Yeah, that's their job. They're trying to eradicate black folks, not us.
Yeah. So how about this? I want to get off of your genocidal part of the conversation.
Okay. It'll come back, Alan.
I mean, I'm sure it will. So a lot of people are really perturbed because not necessarily about the panic of, oh, I'm going to get coronavirus, but more of because coronavirus exists, the Dow went down to 2,000 more points today. The economy's tanking. It's all because of the coronavirus. So it's time for political and economic upheaval, and the Fed should do something, and the president should do something. And then whether he does something or not, we should vote him out and get a new one and let him do something too, and all that and all that. And you want to talk about, you had brought up making use of a catastrophe, whether it was intentional or otherwise. There's all these people on Twitter who are talking about how, well, you know, Trump has based his whole presidency on, look how good the market is. You should thank me, you guys. And now the market tanks. And, oh, he's going to blame. So he's going to use coronavirus and say it's not his fault. It's coronavirus, and vice versa. Other people are going to say, I don't care if it's coronavirus or not. The market's tanking. Therefore, Trump is the worst person who ever lived because he's a failure. And the real answer is that actually the entire system is just rotten to the core.
Right.
The coronavirus, like I want to be very clear with people. The coronavirus is not the potential cause of this. I mean, the bubble may have burst. We may be on the precipice of the next huge market crash,
which we knew was coming before coronavirus.
The coronavirus is not why the market will crash. It was just the pin that poked the bubble.
Exactly.
Yes.
And I have a little wager with a friend of mine who believes that Trump is going to lose. in this election. And I'm like, there's no way, you're crazy. So we have a little wager. And then today he was saying, oh, see, the economy's about to tank. This is going to happen. I'm like, wait a second. What month is this? This is March. We got a long news cycle, and the constituency has a very short memory. If people are not suffering by the time the election rolls around, I guarantee you the Trump administration is going to do everything they can to put a chicken in everybody's pot. Mm-hmm. There's no way that he's going to lose this election. And barring just some catastrophic thing that even Trumpers can't deny, and guess what? They can deny just about anything. I sent him a picture of a lady. I just found, just as I'm scrolling through Twitter, I see some chick that says, I don't care what, if the sky is actually falling, Trump 2020. Like, these are the people we're dealing with. It does not matter. They've personalized this man. He is a deity in their religion of statism. He's their brand, and they're behind him. It doesn't matter. Who he is.
That's true, but when it comes to national general elections, if the economy tanks, Trump loses. Period. End of story. I mean, that's just historical fact.
Right. I think they're going to be able to play it off.
If the bubble has burst, then the bubble has burst, and he's donezo. If the bubble if the bubble can be repaired, then they'll do what they always do, which is kick the can down the road by. Right. Continuing to cut rates, continuing to print money, more stimulus, and it'll put it off until the next trigger that happens. So we don't know for certain. I don't think we know for certain that the bubble has popped. I've had this conversation with a few economists already who have said, and I've just point blank asked, okay, is this it? Has the bubble burst? Mm-hmm. And the general consensus I heard was, I believe so, but for one, we don't know for certain for a little while, and two, the financial sector goes to shit before it hits the rest of the mainstream economy. And we're right. The election's staring us right down the barrel. Right. So it's kind of weird timing. I mean, in some sense, if you had an Obama that was running, who was the presumptive nominee from day one, mm-hmm. Trump would be in serious trouble, even if they could put a Band-Aid on it.
Right.
But since the Democrats are Biden. Running a dementia patient as their presumptive nominee, they might be able to sew this thing back together.
Yeah.
But I mean, it's sad. So, I mean, bringing this back around full circle to the coronavirus, I'm not living my life any differently.
Right.
Like, I'm doing everything the exact same.
Washing my friggin' hands.
I would be a bit off put by people around me that would be taking very strange, like, life altering precautions, like not going out, I read a thing that Target was having Target is a big chain store, and they sell lots of products because they have their mega stores just like Walmart. Right. And they're actually having a hard time filling some shifts because of people that are just point blank saying, well, if I can take a sick day, I'll take a sick day. If I have insurance, I'll use that. If I'm too low of an employee to have sick days or insurance, I'll just call off or, you know, whatever. Like people, they're losing lots of shifts and having to call in a lot of part time because people won't go out. Now, I think that's a bit silly.
That's a bit much.
That's a bit silly. And I mean, even like in the states, like states who like they have three cases, so they declared a state of emergency. That's ridiculous. Mm-hmm. Like those people should drag their governors out of their mansions
but they won't,
because that's ridiculous.
Yeah. You know, Stretch had a project he was doing recently. And so he went to he works at a grocery store. So he went and bought to get a can of Lysol because he needed to sterilize some things. And he uses this other sterilizing thing. And anyways, he got the last can on the shelf. Like, really, people? Like, I mean,
yeah.
It's so crazy to me. I just am like, and why people like this is my wall of toilet paper, because I shop at Costco, so I normally have like a buttload of toilet paper because I buy one of their big packs.
Yeah.
And so I'm like, seriously, I'll sell you some toilet paper. I ain't worried.
Yeah.
I do have a question for you though.
Okay.
Regarding the oil situation. Because
Oil.
I was just, huh?
Nothing.
I was just looking. Oh, oil. The oil situation.
Is it oil? Is it oil or is it Earl?
It
Okay.
depends on what part of the country you're
All right,
coming from. It's
okay,
I
okay.
would probably normally say oil, but so anyways, this, all this tanking going on, I don't know a lot about it. I was listening to the little, snippets of news as I'm walking around the house today, and they're talking about how OPEC was having a meeting, or the Saudis were meeting with OPEC, and they were trying to, like, they're trying to buttress the oil industry, of course, like, because this is not good for them or whatever. But now there's this war that started between Russia's trade war or price war started between the Saudis and the Russians. And people are like, they were making it out to be like, so many people could lose their jobs and blah, blah, blah. And I'm thinking, well, that might be possible, but isn't this good for the consumer? Isn't the whole reason that they have OPEC to kind of make sure that prices stay high so that, I mean, maybe I like I said, I don't know a lot about it. So it
Now,
seems to me like there's something a little backwards there.
so lower prices are better for the consumer all the
Right.
time. And
Yes.
OPEC is terrible because that allows that part of the world's oil conglomerates to form an effective monopoly and hurt
Exactly.
other countries with their policies. What would help consumers a lot and would lessen the effects of any trade war between any OPEC nations and anyone else, at least referring to Americans, would be if we got rid of domestic regulations that made the domestic
Yes.
mining and oil distribution so hard to come by.
Yeah.
If we didn't have those, if it wasn't all the tree huggers that got all of the laws passed so that we couldn't go drill in other parts of the country, drill in Alaska, drill in the Arctic or whatever, then you would have more domestic product,
Right.
which, by the way, it's not like we have zero.
Right. Oh, we have a lot.
A lot of people have this weird, like it's kind of like when your knowledge of something is only skin deep, you're kind of going by the cliche of, okay, so all the oil on Earth is literally
It's
in the Middle
Saudi
East.
Arabia.
No one has any, like none. Like you don't even have cooking oil if it wasn't for your Saudi overlords. And so that's why we don't just, like, that's why we haven't turned the Middle East to glass, right? It's
Yeah.
because literally, it would literally be The Walking Dead, and there would just be broken down cars in the streets with no owners if we didn't have that. So that's not true. But it would be even better if we had more domestic product. That is also true. That doesn't mean that we need the U.S. government to subsidize or nationalize it. You need to let the market function, but you need to. So in a weird way, we're actually kind of doing the worst. Like, nationalizing it would be technically the worst.
Yes.
But in a weird sort of bizarro way, like allowing domestic corporations to drill for oil, but then putting so many barriers on them that there's not a lot of competition,
Right.
and that you're still dependent on subsidizing foreign oil, then that puts you where you are
Right.
in the market. So I mean, it's just a shame that, of course, and it's self-inflicted too, in the same way that Trump passed tariffs to because he wants to try to
Right.
quote unquote win a trade
Which
war
we
with
call
China.
taxes on the poor or taxes
Yeah,
on the consumer.
so not only are those taxes on the consumer, including domestically, but that's also engaging in a trade war with a country that you currently have in a massive debt to because our
Right.
debt is so ridiculous. We have other nations who own it. But then when other countries, so it's like trade wars beget trade wars, right? So then other countries who, I mean, theoretically, if other people have tariffs, you still shouldn't have them because they're still a net negative for the consumer,
Right.
even domestically.
Right.
But because it's like we now live in this weird era where maybe 30, 40 years ago, people finally figured out tariffs were bad, and now we're back.
Right. We're
It's
back in.
just like socialism. It's just like socialism that people had kind of figured out that it was less than ideal, and now it's back.
Right.
And now tariff world is back as well. So
Yeah.
it's really a shame for people. It's a shame for people that I get it. I get that people feel like things that are out of their control are negatively affecting them and it makes them angry. And I totally understand that. Unfortunately, a lot of people believe that the answer then is to go to Big Daddy government and have them even
Right.
the odds.
Yeah.
And it's Big Daddy government, yours or someone else's, or the ones who made the bad odds in the first place. Having them tweak the odds is just furthering their ineptitude to tweak said odds.
Sure.
And then again, coming around full circle with coronavirus, it is a shame that things happen that can cause ripples in the marketplace, and it adversely affects you, and you see people running on toilet paper and Purell and all that, and not covering shifts and whatever. And yeah, I mean, that's a shame. It's the real shame is what affects the market more than you getting sick. Mm-hmm. The chance of you getting the coronavirus is nearly 0%, but the chances of, as people are bitching on Twitter today, the chance of your 401k taking a hit because of the corona,
right?
Because of, I explained earlier, it's not right. really because
it's just a factor.
But triggered by the coronavirus, that is much more likely than you actually receiving the illness yourself.
Right.
But again, the unfortunate thing for people like you and me is that people will be upset, and totally rightfully so, but they're going to be upset and want government to get involved, not get the hell out of it.
Right. And then once they get government involved, so they can take care of this crisis, it never goes away. That always stays in the next crisis they've got more. So I just wanted to make sure. I'm glad you explained that, but I was... Like, I felt like I was on the right track with that, but I wasn't sure. So, because they were making it sound like, all these jobs lost. And I'm thinking, well, people find other jobs. But if consumers mm-hmm. can buy more stuff, that means there's more money in the economy and more incentive mm-hmm. for people to produce. So, it's just the way that they spin stuff, which I think is really... Of course, they're not the friend of the people, right? So, the corporate media.
The last point I'll make too is that, government intervention begets government intervention. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people make the unfortunate decision of thinking that the way to cure coronavirus is with AIDS, like inject yourself with a worse agent to see if it'll kill the coronavirus. I mean, it's like
drink
chemo, right?
Sanitizer.
Chemo, you nuke yourself to hope to kill the cancer cells. Right. I mean, we would like to think that in 100 years we'll look back on that and be like, "Good Lord,
right.
people did that."
It'll be like doing lobotomies back in 100
exactly.
years ago. Why would they
so,
do that?
the real unfortunate thing for people who believe in limited/no government is, we talked about last week and the week before that, federal government passes an anti-lynching bill that makes it a hate crime. And that's not a power delegated to it in Article mm-hmm. 1, Section 8 of the Constitution. Mm-hmm. The problem is that's like 98% of people wanted it passed, whether they know it's unconstitutional and don't care
right.
or don't know it's unconstitutional. They wanted it passed.
Right.
And when a handful of people said, "I'm going to vote no because it's wrong," they got lashed out at. They're running the risk
them.
Of losing their seats. They're running the risk of losing their seats in Congress because
right.
they did the right thing. And so you are disincentivizing political leaders doing the right thing, and you are incentivizing the worst among us to take chairs that they'll give it to you
right.
good and hard, as Mencken said. And this is the same thing. So if coronavirus kills somebody you liked, then there's going to be a parade down your street of everyone saying government ought to do something.
Right.
Even if government A is not appropriate to do anything, or would flat out them doing something makes it worse.
Right.
If people want it, government will give it to them. And then the next time anything like this happens, government will say, "Well, you remember back in March of 2020, we did the precedent of doing this, so we'll do that next time."
We set the precedent, and therefore we can. And that was one of the things where I was enjoying the some of the comments that people were making too. And one of the things that I agreed with and sort of thought was Trump being, why is anybody taking what a president says about this seriously at all? Like, why is anybody even listening? Why is he even commenting on it? It's not something a president can control, or he's not a doctor. He has no mm-hmm. idea. And so people getting mad because he's like, just take some vitamin C, bro. Like, who cares what his opinion is? He's just another dude. He's not in a position to know about these things. So why, like, it's just so funny to me that they want to kill him over this or that when nobody should be looking to government to solve this problem in the first place.
So this is the horrible cycle that repeats itself. So everyone who knows anything about government knows that the CDC, Center for Disease Control, and the FDA, the Food and Drug Administration, are just horrific.
Yeah.
They're just
god-awful. Yeah, wicked.
They're just god-awful by any metric you can measure
yes.
them by. And but if you if you throw up your arms and say, "Lordy, Lordy, help us, the coronavirus is here," and you give the power to government to step in, that's who's stepping in, the CDC and the FDA.
Right.
They will be the one who will, those will be the governing bodies who will determine what to do,
yes,
what drugs to administer, what to approve. And the fat cats are going to get richer, mm-hmm, because they're only going to work with their buddies. Right. If you and me had the cure in our hands, they tell us to fuck off, right, because we don't work and for
one of the doctors, you know, that was talking about this actually made that point. He was talking about a specific drug and the company that makes it. The only drug that really is available for this disease right now is all cronied up with the government. And therefore, there's really not an incentive for them to find another drug right this minute. Like, they're not really looking for better alternatives. Nothing's like, mm-hmm, there's so much that goes into this that's behind the scenes and so many working parts, but to look to a president to know what he's talking about on this is like the worst, mm-hmm, thing you could do. And he's basically, everything that they're doing is proving to you why you don't want government in charge of your fucking healthcare. Like, This is the most brilliant case to be made. They make it on their own. They shouldn't be in charge of it.
So are you know, we have a Pac-Man machine here at the studio. Are you gonna play Pac-Man when you're here?
Sure, if you'll let me.
I mean it's here.
I like Pac-Man. You can play. It's old people, okay, game.
Old people, yeah.
Old people.
We're gonna wheel Sherry's chair over to the Pac-Man machine so she can play. Yeah.
Get my, like, my hand is permanently stuck like this. This is how I'm going to, so I can play with the little.
The claw.
Yeah, like play, yeah, with the stick, yeah, the ball, whatever thing. Oh.
Yeah.
Show. But, and push the button. Actually, it's more like this. Claw button, but you get me.
You got some serious rheumatoid going on right there, I think. Yeah. They're going to find out. If you have arthritis, you can't get corona. That's what.
Oh, well, then I'm safe. I'm safe.
Yeah, you're
for
fine.
Safe.
It's fine. I wouldn't even worry about it.
My daughter has been sick this week.
Yeah. She, well, I mean, yes. It. Yeah. So, well, then, yeah, you're all dead then.
Right. She's getting better. She's a carrier, though. We'll die. She'll just,
yeah,
live on without us and feral in our house. Wow. I can see it. She'll be feral in my house. Like, and people will find, mm-hmm, her like 5 years later. She's run out of candy. You know.
Wow.
Yeah, she can live without us. Well, I know she can.
What a way to end the show.
Goodbye, everyone.
Guys, thank you so much for listening to another episode of Postcards from Somalia. I don't know what episode number this was. What episode number was this?
It's like 84, I think.
Was it? I'll tell you here, remember, in 2 seconds.
Yeah, you look it up and see. It's something like
the last. That. Yeah, it's 84. You were right. Woo! This is episode 84. How,
wow,
about that?
That's,
I know,
incredible.
We're gonna have to do this show's episode 100 then in like, like 3 or 4 months.
Only that'll be, all of us will go buy a 40 down at the liquor store and drink it under the bridge. Some,
wow,
malt liquor.
You got some really big plans then for the episode 100 then, don't you?
I sure do.
All right. Well, guys, thank you so much, and we will see you next week.